be seated. On behalf of the family of Diana Strickland, I want to thank you for being here today to support the family. My name is John Herring. I'm a pastor here. I've been the teaching pastor here for a number of years. Jack and Diane, during retirement years, as you know, served with the Mobile Missionary Assistance Program, and then in the winters at Rio Grande Bible Institute. Not only to serve the Lord, but I heard from the family that Diane liked warm weather, so Texas was attractive, not only for missionary service, but also because it would be warm. That's what I heard. But a number of years of missionary service and retirement, and then as that wrapped up after Diane's tragic accident, they moved to this area, began attending this church, and became active very, very quickly. In fact, they would have sat about right where you're sitting, right here at the end of one of those pews, right there. And right away, you could tell that both Diane and Jack loved God, loved the worship, loved to sing the hymns, loved to hear the Bible taught. Diane was not able to stand or sing like she would have at one point in her life, but you could see the joy in her face. Very, very kind person. I didn't get to know them as well as most all of you, but we have for a few years now. I was able to teach the membership class that they joined. They joined very, very quickly, became members of the church. I led an open small group Bible study on Wednesdays that they joined, and so it's been a joy to get to know them. And they are members of this church and actively participated in so many ways. But we're here today for very specific purposes. I'm just going to take a moment and remind us of those, and then we're going to pray. We're here to give glory and honor to God. We're here to give glory and honor to God. It's God that gave Diane life. He put her, knit her, the psalmist says, in her mother's womb to be just the person he wanted her to be. And when he created Diane, what a wonderful, wonderful woman he created. We're so thankful for that, thankful for her. And so we give glory and honor to God as Diane's creator. We're here to bring thanksgiving and praise to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. As you see, when God became a human being in the Lord Jesus and then hung on that cross, he conquered death and the grave for all of us, but he conquered death and the grave for Diane. You see, there's two deaths that we experience as human beings. Bible calls one the second death, and the second death is separation from God forever. And when Jesus hung on that cross, he took the wrath of God over our sin, over how we've broken and ruined this world. And God's heart of love and justice caused him to respond in wrath, and yet Jesus took all the wrath of God on the cross. Jesus also took all of our guilt and shame. And Diane had put all of her faith in the Lord Jesus as her Lord and Savior. And he conquered the second death, the separation from the Father, and opened wide the gates of heaven. And Diane is really more alive than she ever was before in the very presence of God. But Jesus also conquered the death of our bodies, what the Bible might call the first death, the death of our bodies. For on that third day, he rose again, leaving that tomb empty. And so not only is Diane's spirit in the presence of God, we're going to talk about it more in the teaching, but she's received a heavenly body, free from all of that pain and suffering that she's had these last few years. And so we're here to give glory and honor to God and thanksgiving and praise to our Lord Jesus Christ and remember Jesus' victory on the cross and that empty tomb and the power of Jesus' salvation. We are here to honor Diane Strickland. We are here to honor her. The Apostle Paul wrote these words, "Give honor to whom honor is due." And those of us that knew Diane know that she is worthy of honor. We want to honor her. That's scriptural, that's biblical. And then, of course, through Moses, he gave the Ten Commandments, one of which is honor your father and your mother. And we have a husband, Jack. Children, daughters, grandchildren, that so want to honor their mother today. They want to honor Dad as well. And Jack, I do want to honor you. I ended up deciding not to do it because I wasn't sure I was going to be able to get to talk to you about it before. So I ended up not. But on Easter Sunday, I was talking about God's love. you as an illustration. Your devotion to Diane, your care for her, your celebrating of your anniversary through the glass. You know, there became, and you know this, a point in life that there really wasn't companionship left. There wasn't, you know what I mean, younger life raising kids, and one mows the grass and one does laundry, and you're both contributing and you have a relationship, and you know, the person that you're married to is contributing to the household and the raising of kids and the marriage and relationship, and you love them, and that's all part of life. But there's a stage that happened in your life where Diane couldn't do anything like that anymore. But your love didn't diminish, it didn't change. You didn't love Diane for what she could or couldn't do, you just loved her for who she is, the way our God loves us. I want to honor you for your love and your care for your wife. I noticed that in here, I want to say 63 years, is that right? 63 years of marriage. I told Jack, my wife Connie and I have been married 43 years, so we're just getting started. We're just babies in marriage. But 63 years, I can't imagine losing the one you love after 63 years. And I'm sorry, we love you, we're praying for you, praying for all of your family. We want to honor Diane Strickland today. We want to obey the word of God to honor your father and your mother and honor, give honor to those who honor us. And we're here to comfort the family, to pray that the God of all comfort who comforts us in all of our distresses will so comfort Jack and so comfort this family. And our desire in our heart today is that we wrap this family in love and we lift them up to God for the comfort and care, and we give them our comfort and care. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we enter your presence in the name of Jesus to thank you and to praise you. What a glorious God you are, a God of mercy, a God of grace, a God of justice, a God of love, and the creator of Diane Strickland. We thank you for creating this wonderful woman. We thank you for giving to this family and to all of us, but especially to this family, the wonderful gift of Diane, to Jack, a wonderful wife, wonderful mom and grandma. We praise you and thank you for creating her, making her just the person that you meant her to be, using her to bring glory to yourself and giving her as a gift to this family and to this world. And then, Lord Jesus, we want to give you praise and thanksgiving for your death and your resurrection, for taking God's wrath, our guilt and shame, and opening up heaven. And that Diane is very, very much present, very much alive. Because you conquered not only the death of our bodies, but the second death, our separation from the Father. And she has received eternal life through faith in Jesus Christ. And Lord Jesus, we worship you and praise you. And then Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we ask you to help us to honor Diane. Honor her in our hearts, honor her with words, honor her in song, honor her in conversation. We want to obey that scripture. This family wants to obey that scripture to honor your father, honor your mother. We want to honor her today. Lord, we pray for your comfort for this family. We wrap this family in our prayers and our love, and we lift them up for the comfort and care that only you can give. May they sense a great awareness of your love. Not only today, but especially today, may they have a great awareness of the presence of the Holy Spirit. May each family member just be filled with the love of God, the comfort of God, and the Holy Spirit, even as this service continues. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1 through 10. It reads, for we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. Meanwhile, we groan, longing to be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling. Because when we are clothed, we will not be found naked. For while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened, because we do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. Now, the one who has fashioned us for this very purpose is God, who has given us the Spirit as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. Therefore, we are always confident and know that as long as we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we live by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord, so that we make it our goal to please Him, whether we are at home in the body or away from it. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each of us may receive what is due us for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad.
Van Sickle, I'm Dave's brother and June's brother-in-law, and June asked me to share some memories, some remembrances that she gathered from the family. Memories of Mom and Grandma, as remembered by her three daughters and nine grandkids, compiled by June. As I think through a lifetime of my own memories and the memories of everyone and the memories that everyone else shared with me in preparation for this memorial service, the thing that stands out the most about my mom is what she gave us. It was the most valuable thing any parent could give a child, her time. Many of our memories, as well as the grandkids, were made at Narnia, the lake place she and our dad, Jack, built from scratch and turned into their permanent home. Mom gave us her time in so many ways, walking in the woods, singing, playing games, or just sitting with us when we needed to be comforted. She gave her time to others by cooking for them and making things for them to enjoy. I've heard many stories about how others think of her when they're using an Afghan or something else she had made for them. They also think of her when they find themselves serving others, like my mom and dad did as they worked as part of the Mobile Missionary Alliance program after Dad retired. Here are some memories that others in the family wanted to share with you. Cindy, my oldest sister, remembered that Mom was great at hopscotch. She always participated in any of the games we played. My dad banned her from skateboarding after she fell and was bruised from head to toe. She was no longer allowed to ride a skateboard. Catherine also fondly remembered playing board games with Grandma, like Felix the Cat and Uncle Wiggily. Even when she visited Grandma as an adult with her own children, she would play games with the kids. Often after the kids went to bed, she would challenge Catherine to a card game of spite and malice. Mom also spent a lot of time singing with us to make car rides seem shorter. Aaron, Catherine, Sarah, Emma, Jan Marie and I remember singing silly songs. Old songs like I Have a Daisy on My Toe and Mare's Goats. We all have found ourselves singing these same songs to our kids and thinking of Mom. Heather and Sarah both remember listening to the kids' programs on Saturday mornings on KFNW Radio in Fargo. The station would play songs and special requests, which Grandma would send in for the grandkids' birthday or just a special song that they really liked. When Mom would spend time making things for others, she often got us involved. Cindy remembers Mom being an especially crafty person. Mom enjoyed making things for us girls, so our holidays would always be a special occasion. She always tried to make sure that we had new handmade outfits to wear. Cindy was very proud when Mom taught her to hem them so that she could be part of making the new outfits. Mom taught Cindy, Jan Marie, Heather, and myself how to sew and embroider and cross stitch. I remember her being able to come up with costumes made up of only stuff we had around the house for Halloween. Mom could create anything we could think of. Heather said her favorite memories of her grandma were when she was creating things in the woods, the garden, or at the beach in Narnia. There was an essence of using what you could find or had on hand in a creative way to make something. There is no doubt that this helped shape Heather into the way she looks at things as an adult. Sarah recalls watching her grandma embroider the turtle on a little zipper case to put her pajamas in. When she asked who the bag was for, her grandma told her she was making it for a very special little girl. Sarah was surprised to find out that she was that very special little girl when her grandma gifted the bag to her. When Mom was not playing, singing, or creating something, she always had time just to sit with us. Sarah remembers sitting with her grandma frequently. She was an active little kid. As the youngest grandchild, Isaac doesn't have a lot of memories of being in Narnia, but he fondly remembers the time Grandma spent just sitting with him and comforting him and watching the movie Bambi when he came down with the chickenpox on a visit to Narnia. If you knew my mom, you knew she was a nature lover. Our family spent time outside camping, hiking, looking at flowers, and watching animals. She taught us to be curious about nature, not to be afraid of things, and to always be gentle and kind. She would encourage us to pay attention to the lessons you could learn through simple observation. Jan Marie recalled a trip to Reptile Gardens in South Dakota. We went into the building with all sorts of bowls filled with different habitats and reptiles. The sides of the bowls were slippery, so the animals could not escape. We were impressed when Mom picked up many of the snakes and lizards, showing us the pretty colors, wrapping them around her arms and neck, and generally having a great time. When it was time to leave, we discovered that where we had exited was actually the entrance. When it was time to leave, we saw all kinds of warnings about not touching or picking up the reptiles because they might bite or be poisonous. Luckily, there had been no mishaps while she was breaking the rules. Aaron remembers when he was little and helped his grandma with an injured baby bunny they found in the yard. They brought it into the house to care for it and talked about taking it to Narnia in the morning. When they got up in the morning, they discovered that the bunny had died. She patiently explained to him that sometimes rabbits can get so scared that they can die from that. It was his first lesson in death and made quite an impression on him. Mom was forever finding beauty in the interesting animals God made. She loved to watch the bugs, raccoons, rabbits, woodchucks, snakes, caterpillars, and birds that were all around them at Narnia, and shared her joy for the beauty of nature with all of us. Our mom made us feel special in our own way, teaching each of us things that only we could share with her. Cindy remembers her teaching her pig Latin so that she and Mom could talk, and the little girls, Jan Marie and I, wouldn't be able to understand what they were saying. Samuel remembers spending 6 months learning to read and write cursive backwards so he could write to her that way after she had written him a backwards letter while they were living in Laos. Samuel, I hate to tell you, she taught me that too. Jonathan remembers his grandma always cooking his favorite meals when he was at Narnia, including the big breakfasts and Sunday supper pie whenever he requested it. This was special to him because his mom found it hard to make time to make complicated meals. Grandma had a large teapot collection. They now reside at Dave and June's house in Chatsworth. She could not bear to let them go when Diane and Jack downsized to go into the camper. So many memories. Grandma would let the grandkids pick which teapot they wanted to use for dinner. To this day, Anna cannot see a teapot, tea shop, or tea house without thinking about her grandma. She was quite a tea connoisseur until the latter part of her life when she switched to silver tea, which was hot water. Lastly, as a mom or as a grandma, she taught us all how to love. Whether it was in the loving way she looked at our dad, only most of the time, or the way she would light up when he would come up with another adventure for them to go on. They spent 63 years together, and she was always all in. Looking back, it's clear that my mom shaped the person I became. After reading through the memories that each of you shared with me for this service, it's clear that she did the same for each of you. In Cindy's words, she always loved us all the very best way she knew how.
Many times in my childhood, when we traveled so far, by nightfall, how weary I'd grow. Father's arms would surround me, and gently he'd say, "My child, we're going home."
The treasure is Diane. The treasure is that she knew the gospel of Christ, that she was alive in the Holy Spirit. And the treasure of Diane alive in the power of the Holy Spirit was in a jar of clay. The jar of clay was her body. That phrase means very much like you would think of a geranium in a clay pot, that over time it will deteriorate. But we have this treasure in a jar of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side but not crushed, perplexed but not in despair, persecuted but not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. Listen to Paul's words now. Therefore we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we're being renewed day by day. Jack, I want you to notice that. Paul says that when a believer, and we all will, outwardly their body wastes away, inwardly they're being renewed day by day. You didn't see it, Jack. But while Diane's body suffered the results of the tragic truck accident and her aging and the disease, as her body wasted away, her inner spirit was strengthened stronger and stronger and stronger by God. The Word of God promises it. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Though outwardly we're wasting away, inwardly we're being renewed day for our every day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. Here's the verse I want you to really notice. Thinking of that Piaget developmental stage of children where the child now remembers the covered up toy is still there and reaches for it. Paul's words, St. Paul. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. How do we do that? How do we focus on what's unseen rather than what's seen? Well, first of all, we have to recognize the reality. We have to have that developmental step of God granting us the gift of faith that we come to realize there is another realm known as heaven. There is life after this life. There is in the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ an eternal home in heaven not built with human hands. So I would like to help you, especially I want to talk to all of us, but especially to Jack for the next few moments, maybe this whole time, but I want to talk to Jack. As you saw Diane's body get older and deteriorate, the results of an accident, the results of a disease, and then sadly, her earthly body died. In that room where she was, what you wouldn't have seen is that according to Jesus, according to the Word of God, angels entered that room and took Diane's spirit to be with God. Concerning the death of a beggar by the name of Lazarus, Jesus described his death in these words, and the angels carried him to Abraham's bosom. Abraham's bosom is a Jewish euphemism. For Jewish people, Abraham's our father. To be carried to Abraham's bosom means to be taken to our loved ones who have gone on before. And Jesus, in talking of death, says that angels carry us. So at some moment, as Diane's body got weaker and weaker and weaker and succumbed to physical death, no one would have seen it, but angels entered that room. I don't know, none of us know how angels take us into God's presence, but Jesus' words are angels carry us to the presence of God. There's probably two possibilities. One is that as her body, her earthly eyes closed in death, her spiritual eyes opened and she saw that room filled with angels, who almost instantly took her into the presence of God. In 1 Corinthians 15, it says, the Apostle Paul says, it happens in a moment in the twinkling of an eye. Do you remember that scripture in 1 Corinthians 15? The phrase, the twinkling of the eye, is the time it takes for light to refract in your cornea so you can see colors. That's scientifically what happens. That's the twinkling of the eye. There's actually a little sparkle or twinkle you could see in someone's eye if the light was just right when it hits the cornea. They now tell us that it takes 1/1000th of a millisecond for your eye, when you open your eye after sleeping, how quickly you can see color is about 1/1000th of a millisecond. So Diane's spiritual eyes opened. She was in the presence of angels who almost instantaneously took her to the presence of God. The other possibility is that her eyes closed in death, and the angels gathered up her spirit and took her to the presence of God, and her spiritual eyes didn't open until she was in God's presence. My kids are now grown, like yours, Jack, but when they were little, we would watch Disney movies in our family room. One of the grandkids' remembrances was watching Bambi at your log home in Narnia. So our kids are watching Bambi or something, they fall asleep in the family room. Dad, me, I pick them up in my arms, carry them upstairs, up two flights of stairs in our home to their bedroom, put them in their bed. They wake up in the morning, they're up in their bedroom, but the last they remember, they were down in the family room watching Bambi. It's also possible that angels entered that room, gathered Diane's spirit, almost instantaneously moved her to the presence of the Lord, and her eyes didn't open until she was in heaven, and the first thing she saw was the face of Jesus. So we don't know whether she saw the angels and then God, or the angels took her to God and then she saw God. But according to Jesus and the Word of God, that's exactly what happened. At death, there were angels in the room. They carried or escorted Diane to God's presence. The scripture says we're taken to be in the presence of the Lord. 2 Corinthians 5:8 was read earlier. We are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body to be at home with the Lord. Imagine seeing the face of Jesus. Imagine seeing the full glory of God, seeing the face of God, waking up in God's presence. In the book of Revelation, Jesus speaks to seven different churches, and he makes what are known as the promises to the overcomers. To the church at Sardis in Revelation 3:5, Jesus promises that he who overcomes, and by the way, an overcomer is simply someone who has put all their faith in Jesus. The Apostle John that wrote Revelation wrote 1 John, and he wrote these words, and this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. So faith in Jesus makes us an overcomer. Jesus promises in Revelation 3:5, a promise to the church in Sardis, that he who overcomes, I will confess his name before my Father and all the holy angels. Can you imagine that moment? It really happened. According to Paul, we're to fix our eyes not on what we saw, the aging and death of her body, the results of a tragic accident, but we're to fix our eyes on what was unseen. For what was unseen was angels ushered her into the presence of God. Jesus met her and said, well done, your good and faithful servant, enter into the joys of your Lord. And then Jesus did something like this, according to Revelation 3:5. Jesus said, Father, angels, and angels by the millions, Father, angels, Diane is finally home. Can you even imagine that? That's literally what the Word of God says. At that moment, she was changed into the image of Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:1 was read earlier. Now we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal home in heaven not built by human hands. 1 John 3:2 says, we will be like him, be like Jesus, for we will see him as he is. We will receive, or Diane has received, a brand new body. 1 Corinthians 15, 42-44 describes it as imperishable, glorious, powerful, spiritual body. C.S. Lewis, author of the Chronicles of Narnia, and Jack, did you name the home Narnia? Did you? Yeah, I mean, I assumed that when I saw it in the remembrances and the folder we got, and we talked about the kids and grandkids being at Narnia. So you named it Narnia? Was that a connection to the Chronicles of Narnia? Yeah. It was a magical place like the Chronicles of Narnia. Huh. C.S. Lewis, the author of the Chronicles of Narnia, was a skeptic atheist that became a believer, I think you know that, but an ardent proponent of Christianity and a great theologian. He wrote and believed that if you could see Diane in heaven right now, you would be tempted to fall down and worship her because she would so radiate the glory of God. He based it on a couple of different scriptures. One, when the Apostle John in Revelation went to heaven, he first gets to heaven and he tries to worship an angel. Do you remember that? And the angel says, "Don't worship me, I'm not God." But Lewis based it on a couple of other verses. Let me see, I brought them here today. It's this one, Revelation 1:16, a description of Jesus in his right hand. Jesus' right hand, he held seven stars, and out of his mouth came a sharp double-edged sword, and Jesus' face was like the sun shining in all of its brilliance. And we're told we'll have a body like his. Philippians 3:20-21, our citizenship in heaven is in heaven, and we eagerly wait a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body. Daniel 12:3, Lewis also cited, those who are wise will shine like the brightness of the heavens, and those who lead others to righteousness will shine like the stars forever and ever. I'm not sure it's completely true, though I would agree with Lewis. The Bible would seem to picture that Diane would so radiate the glory of God, if you saw it right now, you'd just about be tempted to hit your knees in worship. And she'd have to say, "Jack, it's just me. Worship God." Can you imagine the power of that new body? A brand new mind. Deterioration of the mind is such a heartbreaking thing, but now we see in part, but a poor reflection as in the mirror. Then we will see face to face. Now we only know in part, but then we will know fully, even as we are fully known. 1 Corinthians 13:12. A new perfect spirit. Ephesians 1:4. He chose us in him before the creation of the world. Diane was chosen by God, by Christ, before the foundation, before the creation of the world. Chosen to be holy and blameless in his sight. Perfect in spirit. In a realm of existence, we have no other word except for to say heaven. No anxiety, no fear, no discouragement, at rest, at peace. And Jack, family, this really took place. And according to the Apostle Paul, he would challenge you today, he does, through 1 Corinthians 4 and 5, to not focus on what was seen. The aging, the accident, what it did to her body, what disease did, what happened to her mind. Don't focus on that, Paul says. Focus on what is unseen, for what is unseen is eternal. And according to the scripture that was read to us earlier, 2 Corinthians 5:5, it was God's purpose for Diane to be in heaven with him. 2 Corinthians 5:5, now it is God who has made us for this very purpose. What very purpose? To leave the tent of this body and to be in a brand new heavenly home. Now it is God who made us for this very purpose, and he's given us the Spirit as a deposit guaranteeing what is to come. Jesus, in his high priestly prayer the night that he was betrayed, before he went to the Garden of Gethsemane, prayed this: "Father, I want those that you have given me to be with me where I am." Jesus prayed, "Father, those that you've given me, I want them to be with me where I am, so that they may see my glory." Was Jesus' prayer for Diane that she would be in his presence and see his glory? And God's purpose in Diane's dying was to bring her to be with him forever. It's the fullest extent of God's plan of salvation. That we come to salvation, we grow to be like Christ, that's called sanctification, and then we step into heaven through the presence of angels, into the presence of God, and that's called glorification. When you think about it at all, is it any wonder that the scriptures would say, "Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints"? From God's perspective, what a precious, wonderful thing. So we choose our focus. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen. For what is seen is only temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. So we make a choice to focus on good memories, to focus on what really happened to Diane. Yes, the death of her body, but her spirit is soared into the presence of God, into a resurrection body like unto Christ's. We need to strengthen our faith The scripture that we read earlier has this phrase in it that was read to us earlier. We walk by faith and not by sight. We walk by faith and not by sight. 2 Corinthians 5:7. Hebrews 11:1. Now faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. Notice Hebrews 11:1 says faith is being certain of what we do not see. 2 Corinthians 3:2. Dear friends, now we are the children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when we see him, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. The word of God, Diane herself, would encourage us to be ready ourselves. In 2 Corinthians 5:9-10, part of the passage that was read earlier, that the family chose for this service today, so we make it our goal to please him, to please God, whether we are at home in the body or away from it. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive what is due him for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. So for all of us, the scripture says, make it your goal to please God. The scripture says you will stand, every one of us will stand before him in judgment one day. And you ask, well, how do we please God? What will we need when we stand before him in judgment? We don't please God by effort, we please God by faith. For without faith, Hebrews 11 says, it's impossible to please God. We please him by our faith. We put all our faith in Jesus, his death on the cross. We put all our faith in his resurrection. All our faith in the Son of God, the Lord Jesus. Nothing in ourselves, all in him. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's a gift of God, not of works, so that no one would boast. Ephesians 2:8-9. Diane is in heaven. So in the presence of God, she's heard, well done, good and faithful servant. She has a brand new spirit, a brand new mind, a brand new body, imperishable and glorious. But that's because of God's grace applied to her through her faith in Jesus Christ. So where are you concerning Jesus Christ? Do you know him? Is he your Lord? Is he your Savior? He can be right now by faith in Jesus, God's Son, who died for you. When we started our teaching time by remembering that small children, there's a stage in which they're too little to realize that when you don't see something, it still exists. We said we're asking God to move us to that maturity step, that just because we can't see Diane doesn't mean that we think she doesn't exist anymore, because she's very much alive in God's presence. And if you've never reached out by faith and put your faith in Jesus as your Lord and Savior, we want to encourage you to do that right now. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we enter your presence, and we thank you for this amazing scripture, 2 Corinthians 4:5. We thank you for this amazing challenge that we should focus our eyes not on what we've seen, what Jack, the children and grandchildren have seen, and Diane's experience on this earth has been wonderful at times, but in recent years been difficult and hard. So we ask that you would hope. Help them to focus, not on what has been seen, but what is unseen. But in the presence of angels, she was taken to be in the presence of God and is very much alive in a resurrection body, having heard, well done, thou good and faithful servant, in the full glory of the presence of God in heaven. We pray that you would help all of us to focus on the unseen. Father, we want to tell you that we're so sorry for our part in this sinful world, that we repent of our sins, that we put our faith in Jesus, the Son of God, who died on that cross to take your wrath and our guilt and shame, and rose again, leaving an empty tomb, that we would have eternal life. We put all our faith in him and all our faith in what Jesus did on that cross. We thank you and praise you as we celebrate the life and honor Diane Strickland right now. We give you glory, and we celebrate what Jesus has done, and we give honor to whom honor is due. So we remember Diane this day, thanking you for her life, her testimony, and that she's very much alive in your presence, in Jesus' name.
Amen. I'm Joe Crenshaw. I'm Jennifer's husband, and Diane's son-in-law. I wanted to just give a brief benediction and then we'll pray again and leave. Could we all stand in honor of Diane? Let's pray. Lord, we praise you and thank you so much for the precious life that you shared, let us have a part in with our friend Diane, our mom, our grandmother, our great-grandmother, and of course for Jack's precious wife. And Lord, I can just imagine that she's in that great mansion you prepared for her in her heavenly home. And Lord, that there's many special rooms in there. And I can imagine, Lord, that you've given her a very, very many rewards for her great faithful service she's done for you throughout her life here on this earth. And Lord, I know there's probably one special reward you've given her. It's a very special teapot. Lord, family and friends know that Dan loved to have teapots and collected many teapots. And I suspect, Lord, the reward that you've given her, one of the many rewards you've given her, is a very special teapot named the purest gold. Beautiful. Bordered with many jewels and precious stones. And Lord, in that teapot, there's water from the river of life. And that water is of the purest love you can imagine. And Lord, she's drinking that now. And Lord, I just pray our family and friends here, every time they drink from a teapot, they remember that special, holy, wonderful love. And Diane is thinking of you, of us all over here. And as we depart, Lord, that we just praise you and thank you for safety that you provided for all of us, and safety for each one that came here, and that you provide us safety traveling as we go back. These things we ask in your precious name. Amen.